Alright, hello everyone. This is the online help session for Lab 6 Morse code. So this one is different because it's going to use the watchdog and the speaker. So this involves pulse width modulation and figuring out how interrupts are supposed to work. So you will definitely want to do systematic decomposition, just like for the last lab. Except this time, it's kind of hard to understand where his code to start with, so I think that's what I'm going to go over first. So this is the raw ASM file. The first thing this does is sets up your clock speed and number of watchdog interrupts. So up here we have system equates, and then referencing our Morse underscore codes file, because we're going to use that as a library for looking up values. This line's very important. It's going to give you the length of time for each base element of the code, because different intervals in Morse code are defined by different multiples of this time element. These are your global variables. This is how you define them, and this is where you should put yours. You may need to create one or two. So this is for the speaker. This one is for a delay. So this is where the program really gets started. He has the string Paris put in. I believe the pass-off string is hello CS124 world. But as he's setting up the stack and the watchdog counter with those dot equates up here, so you can figure out exactly what values he's putting into there. And that'll help you later with blinking your green light. This is initializing a port. It's actually the speaker. This is initializing the global variables. And this is enabling interrupts on the board. So just because you have the watchdog timer set up doesn't mean the board is allowing interrupts to happen. This section has the code you'll need for outputs. So you have your output of a dot, a dash, and a space in this section here. And all three of those together just happen to be A. So what this program does when you load it on your board is it just plays A over and over and over and over. So there is actually a lot of code missing that he gives you. So let's dig through here and find it. Here's the code. So this dot ref is actually already in here. So we don't need that. And then this is going to be the main loop. And I'll explain what all of this does. So we want to copy this and put it in our code. So we don't want this before our initialization, so let's just put this up at the top. So understanding this is where a lot of people get stuck. This pound message is this string here. So this means move Paris into register 4. But it's not actually moving the entire string into register 4. A string in assembly and C is an array of chars. So it's a large array just made up of every individual letter in that string. Every individual letter, symbol, operand, every char. This is actually moving a pointer to the beginning of the message. So it's actually a pointer to the location in memory that's storing this P. So the next line, this move at R4 plus into R5, this means the thing inside R4 is a pointer. It's going to go to memory, get what that's pointing to, in this case, P. So take that P and put it in R5, and then increment the pointer that is in R4. Now R5 holds P, and R4 is pointing at A. So if you didn't understand that, listen to it again. If you still don't understand it, talk to a TA. It's important that you get this. So now we have some arbitrary char sitting in R5. We need to see if it's a letter, a number, or a space. Because if we open the Morse codes.asm, so if you open the Morse codes ASM, you have one table for numbers and one table for letters. They're not all in the same table, so you have to know which table you want to reference to see what combination of dot, dash, and end you should use. In the code here, he references the letter table for you, so you can see how that works. We can figure out if it's a number or a letter or a space by going to here. This is called an ASCII table. You should have talked about it in class. If you haven't yet, you will very soon. Each char shown here in red has a corresponding number that goes with it. So the char is actually this number here, and you can compare that to an int to see if they're equal. We know we're only going to have letters, numbers, and spaces. Space has a value of 32, and our numbers have a value of 48 to 57. And our letters, if we're smart and just use all caps, have values of 65 to 90. So, what we're supposed to put here is figuring out if it's a letter, a space, or a number. Comparing it to see if it's a space is easy. You just compare 32 to what's in register 5, and if they're equal, do a space. However, we don't really want to compare to every number, and certainly not to every letter, to see if it's a number or a letter. So if you look at your hack sheet, you can see there are a bunch of different types of jumps. So for those, you'll want to do a comparison, and then a jump if greater than, or a jump if lower than. So I'll let you figure out how to systematically decompose that. These three lines are actually what are necessary in order to look it up in the table. So up here, we'd have our comparisons, which are formatted horribly. You'll need one case to handle letters, one case to handle numbers, and one case to handle spaces. What this line does is it figures out how far from A your letter is so that it can look it up in the table in Morse codes ASM. If you get a 3, it's going to go to 0, 1, 2, third thing in the table, and it'll get the sequence for D. This is just creating the index by which it can look up the letter in Morse codes ASM. So this line accounts for the difference between a byte and a word, because this index that we've made is a byte, but we need a word, so if you add two bytes together, you get a word. And the way Roper has it set up, just adding the register to itself will work. And then this moves the pointer to that letter into register 5. So it goes into the table, it looks up the letter, and it puts the pointer to the first dot or dash into R5. Then it should go to loop 2, binary 2. And it doesn't matter if you're going from the letters or the numbers loop. They can both use loop 2 and it won't matter. So the first thing it does, we have this auto increment again. So what it's doing is it's grabbing the first thing in our Morse array, as you can see here. So in this case it'd be a dash if it were a B we were doing. And it puts the dash into R6 to be executed. And then it increments this pointer. So now that pointer's pointing at dot. Then you're gonna have to compare it to dot, dash, or end. And it will jump back to loop 10 until it hits end, and then it will go up and get the next letter. If you turn these into subroutines, which it actually says to do in the lab instructions, If you turn these into subroutines, you can just compare it and then call. Each of these can be turned into a subroutine. So you'd have do dot. So each of these can be turned into a subroutine, do dot, do dash, do space. And then you can compare it. And just like we did with the stoplight lab, you can jump if it's not equal over the line that says call do dot. So you would jump to dash. And this would be dash. So if it is a dot, it will not take this jump. It will call this subroutine. And then you'd probably want a line that says jump back up and get the next letter. So jump to loop 10. And then you'll have the same thing for dash and end. So that's basically how to get started. Do your systematic decomposition for that. Now let's talk about the watchdog timer. You can think of the watchdog timer as a way of doing parallel processing. You can do more than that, but it's a good way of explaining it. So basically what's going to happen is your main program is going to be executing, and then every few milliseconds, it depends on what kind of initialization you have up here, how often it'll interrupt. It's going to interrupt and it will execute all of the code in here. And then as soon as it hits this return from interrupt, it'll go right back to where it was in your main program and keep going. So you could have two separate programs, if you will, and it would basically just switch between the two very quickly. So that's kind of how operating systems work. You have all these apps open down here. It's just switching between them so quickly that you don't really notice that they're not all being run simultaneously. And that's what an operating system does. It allocates time and memory to different applications. So what's in the watchdog right now is the code for your speaker and for your delay. So when you call delay, it really just loads, and there was a call delay. Where's delay? Ah! So when you call delay, it really just loads a value into this delay count global variable, and then that delay count is decremented in the watchdog, and then it'll return when that's done. So instead of decrementing delay count, it's just testing delay count. Is it zero yet? And then it's actually being decremented in the watchdog timer. So this is not constantly decrementing. It's being decremented every few milliseconds when the watchdog timer interrupts. You can have lots of different processes going in your watchdog timer, because this code executes the speaker. This bunch of code decrements that delay counter. You're also going to have another section. You're going to need to have another section for toggling the green light. So each part of the code tests, am I doing anything? Am I worried about this clump right now? So this one, is it currently beeping? If it's not beeping, skip this part and just go to the next thing the watchdog's supposed to handle. Are we currently delaying? No. Skip this part and go to the next part the watchdog needs to handle. And that should actually say WDT11 now. And then if it is active, it's going to do this stuff that's handling it. So for toggling the light, it's always active because it's always going to be toggling the light. So basically, you'll be decrementing the counter, and then when that counter hits zero, you'll toggle the light. Okay, I think that's it, so best of luck to all of you, and don't let the speakers drive you crazy.